In a world where Microsoft virtualization is still considered to be the underdog by some. The Hyper-V Amigos enlightened the IT crowds on how they could very well be mistaken.
Yeah, hello Didier. This is a new episode of the Hyper-V Amigo Showcast. I think it took us a while. We did one, I think, in early 2016, right?
Yes, we've been extremely busy, if that's a good excuse.
No, it's not the busy stuff. I think we wanted to wait for the RTM bits, right? So we prepared something, but yeah. It was not so stable, and then we said, let's wait until RTM is there, right?
Yes, that and us being busy. otherwise, that would mean we were lazy.
We were not lazy. No, we were not. So let's see, what are we doing there? We want to show a little bit of storage spaces direct. I'm so fortunate that I have a loaner in my company in the moment, a 4-node storage spaces direct setup from Dell. And actually, we will show the hardware a little bit later in the video. I will explain the hardware, but let's say this, R7030XD. Each of them has two processors. I think it is 2640. So it's 2 8-core systems. Every system has 128 gigabytes of RAM. And the storage is, we have one NVMe in there, so it's a 1.5 terabyte NVMe. That's not nice. An ideal scenario. We should at least have two of them, but one was...
It's a loner system.
Yeah, it's a loner, and I'm very happy with the loner, so we will not complain that we have only one NVMe.
But we will not simulate a failure of an NVMe disk, so we'll be fine.
No, we will not do that. Then we have 4 800 gigabyte SSDs in every system, and I think 8 4-terabyte disks. But actually, let's have a look. What would you say? We have PowerShell commandlets for all of that, and we can see it. So let's switch over to the system. I'm now on one of those systems, and we prepared a little bit of a show for our viewers. So in the moment you see 4 IO meter running in the upper area here, but we will come to them a little bit later. Yeah, but first let's have a look at the hardware and at the cluster. So I will open one of those nice server managers and go to local system, and here we are. We see our processor. It's an Xeon E5 2640 with 8 cores, and we have 128 gigabytes of RAM and 4 of those systems. Every system has one Mellanox RDMA card with 2 ports. So I know you like those cards.
How can you not like them? I mean, the day before they went RTM, I mean, they had the production ready drivers.
Yes, and
I've been able to upgrade 2 lab clusters on day 0 thanks to Mellanox.
Yeah, that's right. And I have
love that. You gotta love that.
I love that. I have the drivers running here. Actually, we can show that in the device manager. So here we see a little bit more hardware. Yes, I have 2
yes.
2-port 10 gigabits cards. I use 2 ports for the VMs, actually, but they don't really do traffic. And I use 2 ports for the east-west traffic, because in Storage Spaces Direct, we have to have a fast network with low latency, and usually we have to use RDMA for that. So I configured that. Then we talked a little bit about the hardware. Let's see the disk configuration. Let me open a little bit PowerShell. This one maybe. So let's do this. So with get physical disk, we see the disks. So, and the special thing is I'm on one of those four nodes, and when we implement Storage Spaces Direct, the software storage bus, every node sees every disk in the node, except the operating system disk. We have only one operating system disk here. Let's see, this is a virtual disk. I prefer to install the operating system in a VHDX, but I see you are moving the mouse.
I'm sorry. Not a problem. I'm just browsing your NVMe
here,
disks.
Right? Here is the Toshiba. Here's the Toshiba disk. This is a local 300 gig, I think a 10K ZAS disk. It has two partitions, or it has one partition with the VHDX on it, and I boot from the VHDX. The other disks, these, are used in the Storage Spaces Direct, and we can count them, of course, or you can say get physical disk. And for example, let's see, there is something like a media type, where media, I should say there, it's a media type, right? It's not working, or am I doing something wrong?
Are you hitting tab? Because I can't see that.
Yes, okay. I did select.
Well, just take a peek at.
So let's see. You should never do PowerShell live.
Yeah,
we talked about that.
Media type is there.
Yeah, it's there. So I, where is it? It's somewhere here. So it should give us the media types, right? Or we can do something else. Order. There is an order, right?
You can sort.
Yeah, it's sort. Sort object. My tab is not really working. Sort object, media type. So let's. So we have to type it, and we don't see the media type. But these are.
We do see the sorting.
We see the sorting, but the standard PowerShell the get physical disk not displays the media type by default. So we had to include it, and I won't do that now. So, but we are sorting by the media type, and these are actually the HDDs. So we have 4 terabyte HDDs in it, and there should be, let's see, this is 4, 8. How many are there?
It's 4 times 8, right?
It should be 4 times 8. So it should be 32, right? But this,
yes.
There are some more. Why didn't he didn't sort correctly? Here are some more. Then we have 800 gigabyte SSDs, 4 of them in each system. That should be easy. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. And we have 4 NVMEs. The NVMEs are actually also SSDs. So the SSDs and the NVMEs have the media type SSDs.
So they're spread amongst each other, yeah.
Yeah. So this is the hardware.
But it's very interesting. We also already see that the NVMe disk have been used for the journal.
Yes, when you install the Storage Spaces Direct, there is the enable cluster S2D commandlet, and it will look for the fastest devices in our Storage Spaces Direct setup. And this is, of course, these are the NVMEs, and use them as the caching devices. And the caching devices have the usage journal, and we have 4 of them, right?
Yeah. One, is this your preferred two, setup?
Three, 4.
With an NVMe system?
Yes. I did nearly 10 POCs and also already implementations with Storage Spaces Direct, and I would say NVMe is a little bit more expensive than SSDs. For the cache you need, it's not that much, especially if you use SSDs that can be overwritten, the whole SSD is, for example, 10 times. Yeah. For the cache, you really need SSDs that you can write a lot of data onto, and then the NVMEs are not really so much more expensive. I saw a diagram, and I think Klaus Jorgensen had it in his presentation, that from Intel, the SSD, the P3710 800 gig was around $1,500. Yeah. And the same device as NVMe, so we have the same flash device. It's $1,999. So it's 33% more expensive than the SSD, but it has it uses the PCI Express bus as an interface. The SSD uses a SATA bus, and it's around 3.5 times faster than the SSD.
And they last a very, very, very long time.
Yeah, and
they're optimized for being overwritten absurd amount of time times, and they are also optimized for concurrent access. So even their commodity NVMEs are so good, you can I think overwrite them about 214 or 217 times, even the consumer grade ones.
Yeah.
So the enterprise grade ones you can overwrite 10 times as much. It will last you for years, even if you overwrite them constantly. So.
I would advise even it doesn't matter what you use. You have to have caching devices and you have to have capacity devices. And even if you use a setup with HDDs, use NVMEs instead of SSDs. That would be my advice from the POCs I've done. If you have NVMEs in the system for the caching, it's much faster than with SSDs. Yeah.
So is that supported? Because some people will read you can do NVMe, SSD, and HDD. So you're saying, well, NVMe is an SSD, so just NVMe and HDD is supported as well.
It is also supported, yes.
Yeah. The only issue you might have there is that you need enough PCIe slots to put them in.
Yeah, actually, it depends on the vendor you are using. I have a Dell Loner here. They go with PCI Express cards, but they have also the option that you can use 2.5-inch NVMEs. I talked at the Dell booth with the guy, so they have also the option that you have like SSDs. NVMe, they look the same as SSDs, but they have, of course, another interface, and it's an NVMe interface on an NVMe switch or something. And
it's a bit like what you can do on a modern client motherboards now. You have the U2 interface, which basically is just a normal disk that you plug into the motherboard, not in a PCIe slot, but it's PCIe as well.
Yeah.
A bit like the M2, the U2 interface, you have that for the servers as well, some interface. Oh, cool.
And actually, we were at the Ignite, we both were at the booth, right? And they are working that you can even hot plug them. So normally the PCI bus is a little bit problematic by removing devices while the computer is running, but they are working on switching NVMe disk if there are defect. It would be nice if you don't have to shut down the computer to replace an NVMe disk, right? So they are working on that. Okay, if we look in the device manager under storage controllers, we should see one Dell Express Flash NVMe device. This actually is a Samsung NVMe. I have also very good experience with Intel NVMEs. Yeah. But Dell uses a Samsung device. So they're okay. So we see here the configuration. Let's go on. I have installed I think 5 virtual disks. So when you implement the storage basis direct, there will be all disks will be put in one pool. So get storage pool. No, that's the wrong command. Storage pool. Bear with me. We have one pool, and in this pool, all disks are in this pool, and this is not a large deployment. So if you have, for example, 60 nodes, you can have up to 416 devices in one pool. They extended the pool several times. When you look at storage spaces, I think the maximum amount of disks in a pool is 84, and with Storage Spaces Direct you have 416. Yeah,
it used to be 200, right? Somewhere along.
It's possible. Yeah, there was a much lower number before, but now with RTM we have 416, and that's 26 devices per node. So that's important. You can't put 60 or 120 disks in one server with JBots and so on. I think the maximum limit in the moment is 26
25,
disks.
25 or 26, something like that.
I think it's 26. Yeah. Good. So we have one pool, and then we have multiple virtual disks in that pool, and I have five of those. And we will show later VMfleet. VMfleet is a test suite from Microsoft. It's open source, and you can test the performance of your Storage Spaces Direct deployment if you have a hyper-converged deployment. And we will talk about that later. But you have to have a special disk layout. So you have to have a virtual disk with the name of the computer. I have four computers. They are called S2D1, 2, 3, 4. And then you have to have a virtual disk that's called Collect. And there all the data is, all the scripts that are running. But we will look at that a little bit later. So Storage Spaces Direct is always a cluster, a failover cluster. And I switched over to the failover cluster manager. Here we see our pool, one pool. We have a capacity of 128 terabyte, but actually, if we create our virtual disk, we use resiliency like three-way mirror or a double parity. We don't really have 128 terabyte. We have less, but there are disks in the system for 128 terabyte. Here under disk, we see our five disks.
Yep.
And they are very nicely aligned, so the cluster virtual disk S2D1 is actually presented on S2D1. This is the owner, and the collect is on some other host. So Storage Spaces Direct is writing the data on different hosts, and it uses the enclosures to know what server. So it should spread the data over more than one node. For example, if you have a three-way mirror, one block should be on the first node, and then the second and third block should be on other nodes. And that it can do that. It has to know this disk are in this host, this disk are in another host. And it uses the enclosure awareness for that. That's not new with Storage Spaces Direct. We had that with Storage Spaces in 2012 and 2012 R2 already. And we see here, I have eight enclosures. I have only four servers, but I have eight enclosures. And this is because the SAS nearline disks and the SATA SSDs are at a SAS controller. This is one enclosure. And then we have our NVMe disk. And the NVMe
everyone controller.
The NVMe controller is another enclosure. So every server has two enclosures in this scenario, right?
Okay, cool.
So whenever you look at the network, the cluster sees four networks. I have a management network where my cluster can communicate with the domain, and we can do backup over this network and so on. And then I have two SMB networks. I didn't do the two network cards in one SMB network. That's possible now with 2016. I choose the old way, separate subnets separate for the two cards.
Sure.
Okay. So, and these two cards are our east-west traffic. So every node has one card here and one card here. And we use Mellanox cards with Rocky. And for that, we have to have VLANs on our cards, and they are all in the same VLAN. Yeah? But this is we don't want to talk too much about networking and the setup.
We discussed this before.
We discussed it before.
Okay. Just go look at previous editions.
We did a very nice video about RDMA. You showed a lot of cool stuff there, and go back and look at that video, why we do that way. So special here is the internal network. This is because of the VM fleet. When we talk about the VM fleet, every VM in the VM fleet uses an internal network to communicate with the host system and, for example, read what benchmark it should do. It looks over an internal network on the host if there is a new file that it should run, and this is the way how the VM fleet communicates with the central data store that is collect virtual disk. Okay. So here are our four nodes. I didn't configure a file share witness or a cloud witness. We talked about the cloud witness before. I didn't do that. So three of my four systems have only a vote in the moment. We don't have to have a witness.
It's highly recommended.
And for example, if we would have a two node storage basis directory, you have to have a witness. A cloud or a file share witness, but I didn't configure
still,
it.
Still, you didn't configure it, but just let's just put it out there. Always configure one.
Yes, I would also advise that. But I'm running the eval version, and it's only out for the eval is a little bit longer out. But I hadn't had the time to do the full setup. Let it that way. Okay, and then we see here. A lot of VMs. Actually, this is the VM fleet. We have 15 VMs running on every node. So let's see it here. 15 on the S2D1, 15 on S2T2, 3, and 4. So we have, in sum, we have 60 virtual machines later to do some tests. Okay? Do you think I have explained everything about the setup that we have to know?
I think so. Looks good enough.
Okay, so let's go back to our four VMs here. When we open the Hyper-V manager, we have to explain there are two deployment possibilities with a storage spaces direct scenario. We have the converged and the hyper-converged scenario. The converged is we use our storage spaces direct system only as storage, right, Didier?
Yeah.
And converged. The converged. So we have our Hyper-V hosts on our Hyper-V systems are separate on other hosts. We use SMB3 to use the storage basis direct system as storage. This is not what I've set up here. I have set up a hyper-converged scenario. So Hyper-V is running on every host. On all four nodes, we have also Hyper-V. And you see it here in the Hyper-V manager. I have here the four nodes, and on every node is a benchmark running. The other VM fleet VMs are turned off in the moment, and I also have Azure Stack TP2 here, but we will not talk about Azure Stack TP2 in this showcast, maybe in a later one, but not now. So here are the benchmarks running, and I have a benchmark on every of these four systems. And if we look in the settings, we have one virtual processor.
Only one.
So okay. I think that's important. And the benchmarks are doing 8K IOs, 70% read, 30% write, and I have a mixed sequential random workload. So they do 50% sequential, 50% random IO.
So but we have to applaud you. It's actually a bit of a more realistic workload.
Yeah, I don't like. I think it's cool if you see 4K IOs only read. But what are you testing? Then you are testing your cache, right? So I like to have a little bit more of a realistic benchmark. So I put in some writes, and these are 30% writes and also random. And but I like these numbers here a lot. So we have. We have now around 50,000 8K IOs on these systems. And if we look here, this is this PowerShell script is part of the VM fleet. It's called watch no, I don't know exactly. I think watch cluster or so, and it will connect to the numbers on every host and display them here. So we see our S2D1 node actually is doing 50,000 IOPS. That's one of those nodes, and in sum, our storage space's direct system has 200,000 IOs and 1.6 gigabyte of IO bandwidth, 1.1 gigabyte read, and around 500 megabyte writes. And we are only doing that in four VMs. And I think that's very nice because...
That's impressive.
It's very impressive because normally you don't get... so much IO with one VM, and this is only one processor VM, right? So yeah. Why did I set up this? I want to show a little bit, or we want to show a little bit of the storage QoS feature that's also working in Storage Spaces Direct. Didier, will you tell us a little bit about storage QoS?
So the couple of important things that are new in 2016 is that you now have maximum, which you already had, but you also have minimum. So, and those minimums will be enforced. So that means it's no longer the case that you get this little event warning that can be, well, read and shown to the operator. No, if you say, look, my VM needs to get 200 IOPS or 500 IOPS, it will make sure that the VM can get it if it's available in the system. And if it's not available in the system, it will also tell you that you have a problem. But as long as the storage array can deliver those IOPS, there will be a guarantee that those VMs get them, even if other VMs are trying to take the IOPS. The ones that have the minimum IOPS enforced will get their minimum IOPS before the other ones can run off with the IOPS. So that's new. Also, what you can do is you can set the IOPS dedicated, which means that if you put a virtual machine on a dedicated policy, that virtual machine, or better, the virtual disk or disks of that virtual machine in the policy will get what is configured in a policy, either maximum and minimum. So if you say maximum is 10,000, each disk of that VM that's in the policy, if you've put them all in the policy, and normally you would do that, you'll see that they get 10,000. But then there's also the aggregated policy model, where you can say, look, in this policy, the maximum IOPS is 50,000. So if you take one of your single VMs here and put that in the policy, it will get 50,000. Now, if you put 10 of these VMs in that same policy, they'll each get about 5,000 because it's an aggregated policy. So those are the two models that you have. So two models, aggregated and dedicated. Aggregated means actually you share the amount that is defined amongst all the hard disks of the VMs that are in the policy.
Yeah.
And the dedicated means that, well, you set that disk will get X amount of IOPS, minimum or maximum, that is valid for each and every disk. And the big difference with the previous version is that you now have minimum QoS also enforced. And it's a policy, which is quite easy to create and assign to virtual disks.
Yes, you explained it very well. And I prepared a little bit of some policies. So these VMs already have assigned a policy, but I haven't put any limitation in the policy. So because it's a little bit hard or a little bit harder, you have to assign the policy to the disk.
Yeah.
Yes. And I wrote a little bit of a PowerShell function to do that. You see it here. It's called something like set VM storage policy. I can give a computer name, a VM name, and a policy ID to that because the benchmark one is running on S2D1. I'm doing the PowerShell command. It's on S2D4. So we have to remote a little bit and assign the policy. So I did that in advance. The one and two, let's look here. The one and two, let me find it in the script. So here's benchmark one. The benchmark one has the dedicated policy. The benchmark two has also the dedicated policies. You talked about that. So if we say we have a dedicated policy with 10,000 as maximum, each of those machine will get 10,000, right?
Each disk in that VM, actually.
Each disk. We have only have one disk here, so let's do that. Actually, we have our dedicated policy here, and let's put here 10,000, and let's run it. This line. So benchmark one and two. Let's see.
Presto! There we have it.
There we are. This is 4 and 3. Nice. I messed up my policy.
Okay.
Sorry for that. But you see, the aggregated policy actually is the dedicated, and vice versa. So let's see. You see the effect here. We have around 10,000, and here we have also 10,000. So I messed up a little bit the naming of my policy. Okay.
Yeah.
So let's do the same that you explained. These two VMs should be in a aggregated policy then. So let's put 10,000 here in this aggregated policy, and hopefully I didn't do anything wrong.
That takes a while to kick in, only. There we go.
Yeah. So we see here 5,000.
5,000. Yeah. Together that's 10,000, right?
Yeah.
The total of the aggregated policy.
And
so
that,
for the viewers, if you would put 10 VMs in here, that would be 1,000 IOPS per VM because it's the aggregated policy.
Exactly, how you said it. So what I didn't test, what is the maximum IO one virtual machine can get? So maybe we should try that. I will remove the policies. Yes?
Okay.
So let's see. I know I will not remove the policies. I will set the policies to zero. I have prepared
and
that.
And zero means for the viewer?
Nothing is configured. There's no limitation. There's no minimum guaranteed and no maximum guaranteed.
So that's the trick to have your policies in place, but not have them be active, actually, right?
Exactly. So to get the policies to the disks is a little bit tricky. You need a little bit of PowerShell, or you have to go to every host and then put the policies there. But I prepared that in advance and messed it up, as we have seen, with the name. So
just a little bit.
So let's see if we, for example, could pause this one, and this one. And why I'm doing that? To see how much this VM can get. So we have now nearly 60,000 IOPS, right?
Yeah.
Oh, there were around 50,000. So this VM can get a little bit more.
But let's fix it. That was only one CPU.
It's one CPU. Yes, we can see
so
that.
That's important.
Yeah.
I mean, probably you're hitting yours. Can we have a look at the CPU actually?
Of course. You mean how much CPU it's using?
Yeah, just take a look at the CPU in the VM.
I have only core installed, so it's a little bit weak. But I think we can do that. Let's see. The problem is I did them very so. First here, our access specification 8K, 70% read, 50% random.
And it's random, yeah. Nice.
So let's see if we... I can't do the control alt delete for the task manager. Maybe I can get the task MGR. Yes, we can. So here we are, 92%. So
which is normal if you... It's
the one core is doing a lot of work, right?
Yep.
So let's go back here. If we get the IO meter again. No, it's still running. Where is it?
It's over here in the third one.
This one, should it be?
Yep. All right.
Restore. Yeah, here we are. So here are the other ones. I use the enhanced desktop mode, so I can shrink the VMs a lot, so that we get four of those on a screen. So I have to log in again. This benchmark VMs have an auto lock on. You shouldn't do that in production, of course. But if you want to show a little bit with benchmarking, start them and they go directly to the IO test. You don't have to do anything. But if you want four of them on this small screen, you have to do something there. So let's, we have to wait a little bit. Here's the last one I paused. And I don't use a very complex password.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
No, it's a little bit more complex, but it's let's say it's password in it. Let's see if we can get it better on the screen so that we see all. How is this thing called in English, Didier?
The speedometer. Speedometer. Yeah.
Okay. In Germany, we have a different word for that, of course. So now we see all four again, and I want to guarantee this one, the benchmark one, let's say 55,000 IOPS. It was around 59,000, so it could do more IOPS, but I have a problem with my recording, my Camtasia recording.
Okay. Mine says it's still going strong.
That's really
so the backup is here still.
Okay. But I don't know why. I have enough free space. Let's continue. I hope it's continuing. So let's pick the VM1, the benchmark one has the dedicated policy, right? So we put 55,000 in the dedicated policy. 55,000.
Yes.
But both of those are in the dedicated, so I don't know what's really happening then.
Well, if they're both dedicated and your array can deliver it, it will give it to you.
Yeah, but we don't.
Of course, if it can't deliver 55,000 to your VMs, if you do a query for that, you should be able to see it, that your cross policy isn't being met.
So you think with the get storage QoS flow? That's also nice.
There's normally something with a status. I don't know it by heart, but you can look at the status. And if the status is okay, the policy is being met. And if you have an issue.
Yeah, this is nice. My son is now working. Okay, but we don't want to show the QoS. It seems that this VM is getting more, but actually it didn't work. But that's okay. We are doing this stuff live, and of course something will not work when you do it live. So let's show the other things. I think this with the IO is very nice. I like the IO we get with only one virtual CPU. I think 50,000 8K IOs and a mix of read, write, and random and sequential is very impressive, right?
It is. This is just a VM. I mean, how many people have this four VMs pulling together 200,000 IOPS out of your storage array? Because that's what you have to compare it to, right? It's the storage array for your company.
Yeah.
So that's out of a box with four VMs running, you're pulling 200,000 IOPS of that thing. So
very impressive.
We call that not too shabby.
No, not too shabby. Yeah, that's right. So we want to talk a little bit about the VM fleet. That's a test suite from Microsoft. It's available at GitHub. It uses disk speed. That is a benchmarking tool to test IO, right? So I will let them run. That's not a problem. So I started all the systems, all the VMs, with a command that called start VM fleet. you have the possibility to create the VMs with VMfleet. It's asking you for a disk and asking you how many of them you want to create. So it's very nice to get 60 disks, 60 VMs on the machines. Yeah. And then I started them. And if we look in one of those, it will take a while. Let's see. We are on the fourth. Let's take this one. And do not the enhanced desktop mode. It is actually a core. I installed Windows Server 2016 standard in the core version, so we don't need too much space per VM. If we use a full installation, you need 15 gigabyte per VM, and we won't use too much for the operating system. Of course, it's a disk test, so we need space in the virtual machine for our test file.
Yeah, you need to write something.
And disk speed has done, I think, a 10 gigabyte test file in every VM. So our VMs need a little bit space.
Are these dynamic VHDXs or?
Yeah, I think so. You can do fixed, of course, but I did dynamic. So now we see in these VMs, use also the auto start. It wouldn't help if you fire up 60 VMs and had to log on each system. So the VM fleet will configure auto start in each VM. That's of course not secure, but this is only a test suite, right? Yeah. So and then it the VM will connect through the interface. Let's do a control C here. So if you do an IP config. You see, our system has one of those RPPA
addresses.
Our host has also an RPPA address. The host has always a 1.1. Yeah? So if I ping 169.254.1.1, we reach the host where the VM is running. So this VM is running on S2D4. Yes, and it will use this internal interface to connect to the host, and I think it's mapping a drive. That's net use. Yes, here's our drive L. It's on the host C cluster storage collect control. And in this directory, I'm here in this directory, there is the VMfleet PowerShell scripts. So, and it looks periodically for a run something PowerShell commandlet, and it will run in the virtual machine the PowerShell script that has the latest date, and the latest date here is the run minus RITS. RITS is something we use for Rachfahl IT solutions. So.
Okay.
So I can now modify this script, and all the 60 VMs will look periodically, I think every 5 seconds, into this directory and look, oh, there is a new script. Let's copy that script in the VM and run it. So we can, with the VMfleet, we can very nicely test different pattern and don't need to shut down the VM, get it somehow, the test pattern into the system. Go away, my son. And we can so test, for example, do 64K with so much read, so much write, and so on. That's very nice.
Okay.
So let's see. So I will restart this machine because I stopped the scripting here. Let's start it again, and let's see what's in this script. ESA run RITS PS1. So, what's happening here? Okay. It's opened very small. Here's the script, and it will do a disk speed with parameters we have here in our variables. The dollar B is for the block size. It's in K, so 64K. T is threads. O is outstanding IOs. And the W is for the write, how many writes we have. And this would be 30% write. So this is, if we do an 8K here, it's it's nearly like the benchmark tool is doing. So now if I save it, it will have a new date. So we see here the 15th of October.
Yeah,
and our VMs are doing nothing in the moment because they are in the pause state. That's also nice. We can pause the benchmarking. All VMs are running, but they are actually not doing any I/O. So when I clear the pause, and we look here into the VM, it actually saw that it's cleared, and now it's doing the testing. And we see here something happening with our I/O. It's going down from 50,000 to 4,000. And let's see the nice small PowerShell script. We are doing now 275-ish IOPS. These are, of course, 8K IOPS. We have a mix of read IOPS and write IOPS, so 160,000, 70,000 read IOPS and 70,000 write IOPS. And these are
nice
8K IOPS. So I think this is really nice, isn't it?
Yeah.
If we want to have bigger numbers, we use larger blocks. So we will get less IOPS, but more bandwidth. So I have seen, I think, 12 to 13 gigabytes of I/O to our system. We can test that if you want to. So you can play with the benchmarking or with the pattern you are testing. And I think that is very, very nice. Where's my ether? It is here. So let's do, for example, 0.5 megabyte IOs.
Yep.
512.
So lots of small IOs.
Lots of big IOs. 512 kilobyte IOs, not bytes IOs. You get it, Didier?
Yeah.
Half a megabyte. It's not small IOs. So here, our IOPS went down, and it's still getting up speed. No, it's not. Ooh, really.
Look at that. Yep.
Here, you mean the benchmark VM. It's not getting much I/O, right?
But I'm looking at your IOPS and your bandwidth right now, which is like...
It should be better.
25, 7...
You mean the I/O meter, right?
Yeah, that's a bit sad at the moment.
It's a bit sad, yeah. I had better numbers, so let's go only to show it. Let's go to a complete read I/O. Let's put away the write part. And here our VM will get the new file very soon. I like this fleet very much. It's so cool to play a little bit around with the pattern that you are testing. And of course, we overdid it. We have now here a lot of latency. And that so this is, if our system would have those latencies, this is not...
Somebody would not be happy.
Nobody would happy, actually. So we can test the limits of our storage system, but of course also the latency. Now the latency is in an area that's okay-ish, it's not good. And now we have 14,000. Nah, it's not picking up. The problem is I transported the system yesterday and had...
You mean physically or?
Yes, I had it in my car and I started it this morning. Maybe not everything is well aligned. Okay, but now you see here, something is happening in the VM. Whatever USO client is, it's not an Greek drink, I said, I would guess. So now we have a little bit more bandwidth, but it's not stable, okay? So I overdid it. Let's go back to maybe 4K IOs.
Okay.
Yeah. But we only want to show, give our viewers an impression what's possible with such a system. And let's see what's happening here. They pick up they have to pick up, all the VMs have to pick up the new pattern.
The new script, yeah.
And now we see our benchmark, our IO meter is getting more IO. Here we have more IOPS. We have now 290,000, very small ones. 400,000, 500,000 IOPS. That's nice. That's very nice. But of course, it's only read IOs now. So we are not writing anymore. Mm-hmm. And the system has a lot of SSDs and some NVMEs. So we are actually testing the performance of our fastest devices, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So now we have nearly 1 million IOP. I would like to see that. Would be great in a video, right, Didier?
Yeah. So
but we only get 900,000. Low. Maybe let's stop this.
Maybe if you play with it a bit, we can push it a bit.
I will shut down the benchmark VMs. Do you want to invest the time? I think it's...
Yeah, sure. Let's try.
It's impressive.
Let's tweak it a bit. Let's see where we can get.
First, let's shut down the benchmark VMs.
It's always fun if you can say that, you know, you have a loaner system just to play around with, and you can just grab 1 million IOPS of that thing.
That would be very nice to have that in a video, right?
Let's do it.
But the problem is we are around 900,000. So what can we do to get more IOPS?
What are we running now?
We can do 2K IOPS, right?
Yeah, drop it. Drop it down.
So let's
512 bytes, whatever. Come on.
I don't know if you can do that, but
0.5.
We can do 1K IOPS.
Let's try.
Let's see what's happening. Did I save it? Yes, I saved it.
You've got it open already somewhere else?
I don't hope so. Let's see. No. Okay. Why is this thing not? So don't do that what I'm doing now. I turn off the VM. But it's not turning off. Okay. So let's see. I will close this one.
You're running as administrator, that's okay. So that should work.
So let's open the
RITS one.
Yeah, it's the run RITS, right? I'm not at the right path. I have to go to cluster storage, collect, control. There we are. Run RITS.
Yes.
So maybe 1K.
It's saved.
Yeah, it's saved. It should pick up the IOs, right?
Yes.
Or maybe we hit a boundary.
I don't know. Save that one?
Yes, it's already here, you see?
Yeah.
The latency is very nice in the moment. So you see here we have 0.2 milliseconds. So it's below a millisecond. That's really nice for the amount of IOs. But we don't get our 1 million IOPS, right?
No, it's gone down.
Yeah, it's gone down. So let's see if we do a 4K. Of course, we can increase the threats and the outstanding IOs. But
that might be a good idea.
So you think 16 threats?
At least, yeah.
And 40 outstanding IOs?
Yeah, let's do that. Let's see what happens. How many cores do the fleet VMs have?
I assume, let's see, one or two? One. Yeah. But we were nearly at 1 million, and maybe we shouldn't go there. We want to show something else. So let's. Oh, he's still grabbing the 2K8.
Yes,
so he is. He's not grabbing the right file, huh? I have 216.
Save.
I did it. Let's see. Okay. Something's wrong there.
Right. It's gone up now. It's going up now. It's 742.
800.
Keep going.
It will not reach the 1 million.
Come on, keep going.
Why not?
Keep going.
887.
Don't discourage it.
933. Ah, no. Come on. No. But we are nearly at a million. So you never know. We could tweak it, and maybe we'll get 0. there.
0.05, but you want to show something else instead of tweaking this.
Yeah. But I think also 920,000 is very impressive for this system. Well, it's a four-node system. We will include a video a little bit later. Not much later, but a little bit later, where we show the hardware, and it's
just for our understanding. What if I would say now I'm a bit of a skeptic customer, and I say, yeah, this is very nice, Carsten, but you know, once you've depleted everything in those fancy NVMEs of yours, what happens to my performance?
Oh, the NVMEs are only for caching. So every data that is cached through the NVMe is written down to the capacity devices. And in our scenario, we have for the writing, we don't have the time to talk about the hybrid disk. But there are, of course, there is a nice Ignite session from Klaus Jorgensen. Look at the session for the hybrid disk. But in essential, our virtual disk has a part of mirror. A part is a mirror disk, and or a part is in mirror, and the other part is in parity. And in our example, we have for the mirror part we have SSDs, and for the double parity part we have HDDs. Every data that is cached has to be written on the capacity devices. So of course the cache helps with the performance, but then the data has to be written down. And here a lot of data is coming down. So the NVMEs are full after a while, right?
But I'm just trying to establish here that some people are skeptical about these sorts of solutions because they say, look, this is smoke and mirrors because you're really only leveraging the high performance devices. But what in realistic workload? But what we're trying to convey here is that this is quite an impressive workload of 60 VMs already hammering the system, right?
Exactly.
And still getting the performance that is quite impressive.
Yeah, and we were at 938,000. So maybe when the whole system warms up, we will reach 1 million, but we'll not wait for that because we want to show a little bit. It's nice if we have four servers running, but what is happening if one server has a problem? Or
oh yeah, but what happens to my performance if one of the nodes crashes?
Oh, we should do that, right? I need the setup.
I have to remind you.
Yeah.
Let's take node one.
We shouldn't take node four, right? Because we are looking at node four. So I prepared the
IDRAC. It would still work, but we wouldn't be able to see it.
We wouldn't see anything. And I hope your session is still recording because mine is not.
Mine says it's still recording.
That's nice. Okay. So here we
Let me check this space while you talk.
So I have a connection to the system. There is a I think it's called base management controller. And in every system, Dell has the iDRAC, and I connect it to all four systems here. And we can turn off one of those systems because powering it down or shutting it down is okay. So the cluster can do a lot of stuff. But if we turn it off, and I must confess, I never did that before, but we will do that now for you. I am at the S2D1. You are about to execute a server control action. Are you sure you want to continue? Yes, I want to. Maybe I have to re-log in. That's the problem. We opened it.
Yeah, it's timed out.
So it's still running. So the 900,000 IOPS is still.
But your DRAC session times out, so you have to log in again.
Yeah.
Then go to power.
Then we are here at power state.
And just shut it down. Power off system. Apply.
Apply. And don't do that, but we will.
Of course you can. That's why it's there. This is a lifesaver. I love DRAC. Really. Yeah.
So here, our cluster We have some I/O problems in the moment, but it's still running. We see that.
Why do you think that is?
Oh, we see something here that's nice. Now the host is isolated. Yeah, that's a new feature in 2016 failover clustering, and you talked about that at CDC, yeah, for example. Yeah, yeah. So the system, they don't see it, but they think, or they say, oh, it's not gone, I can't see it.
Can we take a quick peek at the VMs?
Of course, we can do that. We can do that. We have to scroll up, and they unmonitored.
Unmonitored state, yeah. And if you look at the Hyper-V manager for node 1,
we shouldn't. Yeah, but I turned the system off, so it's gone.
Yeah. But it's kind of cool.
Yeah, it's cool. For the cluster, says I can't reach the node. Yeah, but that's okay for me, because maybe we have a network glitch, we have a network switch booting, I let it be. Yeah. And even if the node would be running and can't communicate to the other host, the VMs would run there. But of course, I turned it off, so there is nothing running there, right?
Yeah, but this is not going to last forever.
No, it will take about 4 to 5 minutes, then the VMs will be started somewhere else.
And you can tweak this, right?
I can tweak it.
So if you want this to be more or less, you can, depending on your needs and your environment.
Yeah, you can tweak it, but not now, right?
Oh, no. I'm not suggesting that you wreak havoc on the demo. But
yeah. But if we look at our other VMs, they are still running, and they are still doing a lot of IOs. One of our node is gone, right? So our VMs are still running, and we have 500,000 IOPS still. So what about Didier when we turn off a second node? Should we do that? Because the promise is with Storage Spaces Direct, you can lose 2 nodes. I can't hear you, sorry.
If you have enough nodes.
You have to have 4 nodes at least. So
There's no magic. If you have 2 nodes, Storage Spaces Direct,
you can turn off two nodes.
There's no more IOPS.
Yeah, but let's turn off a second one.
Number 2?
Yeah, but I have to re-log in here, of course. So let's do that. And I will get the nice login screen again.
So DRAC is really nice. This allowed me to upgrade all my lab systems remotely from my home office at night when RTM came out. So I'm now running 2016 cluster nodes across 3 generations of hardware.
Oh, cool.
And it all went so smoothly, the rolling cluster upgrade. I actually tested the in-place upgrade without even removing the nodes from the cluster, which is supported now. And it worked.
Okay, very
kind
cool.
It was kind of cool.
So Didier, let's see here. I'm on the second node. Yeah.
Yes.
This is the IDRAC of the first one.
Power off.
I powered off. I will do that for our viewers. So let's do an apply, and there I do it.
Zoom.
So I think something will happen here. So we see we have no I/O from the system because we can't connect to it anymore. It's gone.
Yeah. Let's go have a look at the nodes again now in the cluster.
Yeah, you see here we have more VMs unmonitored. Let's see the node. Yeah. We have 2 isolated, and the I will assume. Yeah. But the S2D1 will be soon in not isolated anymore.
Should be gone soon.
Yeah.
Let's take a look at the rules.
Oh, no, it's down. Did you see it?
Oh, is
just,
it down?
It just happened.
Yay!
Just happened. Yeah.
So that means that if you look at the rules,
they are starting on other hosts,
right? They are starting
on
another node.
They are starting on node 4 and 3. These are the only 2 nodes we have left in our 4-node cluster. That's very impressive. Yeah. I like it.
Yes.
And our system is still running. We have still 300 something thousand IOs, and 2 of our nodes are gone. A lot of disks are missing, actually, right?
Yeah. You've lost half of the capacity of the disks. You've lost.
Yeah, maybe this is a problem with. Let's Let's do it again. Watch cluster PS1. That happens sometimes. So you see here. We have two nodes running IOs still. So let's. There is another nice thing. We didn't talk about that when we talked about the video, but we have this nice health system there.
Yes.
And we can get information what's wrong with our system. So we have a lot of errors in the moment, and maybe we should look at the health system. Huh?
Okay.
So if I do get physical disk, we will see a lot of disks are missing. Lost
Oops.
Communication. Half
That's
of our good. Devices are gone. Yeah.
Because so now you panic, right?
Normally you would panic, yeah. But our system is still running. You see here. He has a little bit of a problem again. But this is only a problem reading the counters. We see our VMs are running here. We have some unmonitored because one node is isolated, one is down. When the other one will be down, the VMs will be started on the other hosts. And the two remaining. So let's wait
Looking
for that.
Good. Looking good.
Yeah, we have IO. So with the health system, I prepared something in PowerShell. You can have a look. So we have this debug storage subsystem. And if you actually do that, it will be written correctly. Let's do that. He said everything is fine. That's fabulous, right?
Well, everything is fine. What are you complaining about? I mean, your VMs are running.
No,
your business
not.
Is up.
It's not
right?
Actually, you know. Yeah, if you put it that way, everything is fine. Our clustered Windows storage is healthy, but if you look here, we have a lot of disks missing. Let's see how the pool is behaving. Storage pool. We have a warning because half of the disks in the pool are gone. It's degraded. And if we get virtual disks, we see all our disks are degraded incomplete because there are disks missing in the moment where data of this virtual disk is stored, and it can't be the operational status shouldn't be okay. It's working. We can work with our data. We can write data into it. We can read data from our virtual disk, but of course it's not healthy. Yeah. So let's see if we get a health report. Yes, that's also very nice. We see the average CPU usage, the capacity, the IOPS total, and so on. That's nice. And storage health action. Yeah, he wants our cluster would like to do something about the health, right? So restoring resiliency of the data is paused because it can't do that.
Why can't it do that now, Carsten?
Yeah, because we don't have the disks for restoring it. The disks are gone. So when we start up the two nodes, and we will do that, it will start to restore the resiliency, right?
But if we had a cluster of, let's say, 6 or 7 nodes, we'd still be able to do that.
Yeah, if you wouldn't use all the space in your cluster. If you left space for the space of the disks of two nodes, it could repair it. Right. That's right. Yeah. Okay. So let's do that. And actually, we will take this line. It will get the storage jobs that the system wants to do, and sleep for 2 seconds, and then ask the system for the storage jobs again. Yeah.
Okay. And now we're going to start the nodes.
Exactly. We will start our two nodes. So we power on the system, the first one.
Okay.
And the second one.
If you go to the virtual console, you can see the progress of the boot.
Yeah, I don't have Java installed on the system.
No, you'll just see the small little preview.
Okay. You mean, where is it? Where is it?
Yeah. Server. Go to server.
Server. You mean this small window here?
Yes. And it supports HTML5, by the way.
So we should.
There we go. It's booting.
It's booting.
CDUFI you're boot. Right.
Yeah. Yes, we do that. We do that on the other server too.
Yes, and if you try and play with HTML5, that's supported now in the latest firmware, so you don't need Java.
Yeah. So I will. We will insert the video now because the repair process will take some time, and I will insert a video where I talk about the hardware and show it a bit. So we don't have to wait for all the time for the repair process. We will come back in this in the showcast and see how the system will finish the repair. Or first, let's wait for the start of the repairs.
Maybe yeah, would be nice that we see some action going on there.
Yeah, so we are still booting the system. So we see a progress bar here of the live controller. We can actually connect to one of those systems. Let's see if it's working. You think I have to configure something to use HTML5?
You can choose auto, you can choose Java or HTML5 normally. So hang on, can I have a peek?
Yeah, of course. Maybe in the settings.
Look at the DUX settings. Well, normally you configure it before it's down, of course. Yeah, but that's not a joke, it's true. Normally, you go to the remote access and you say which type of. That's normally what I do. Can we change it on the fly? I don't know actually.
Let's see if we can ping the system. Maybe, yeah. Let's close this one. We have our small window where we see a progress here. Let's wait. Wait. Come on, show it.
Hang on.
It won't show it.
Yeah, it will. There it is.
Yeah, it's black. Oops. Don't mess with the system. Let's see this one. That's the second one.
It's at the whirly. It's at the whirly. Nearly there.
Yeah, you see, yeah, the whirly. Okay, let's.
You're not installing updates, are you?
I hope not. So, so here we see both systems are down. The storage jobs are at 0% and suspended. Yeah, and the system knows how much it has to repair. So how much data it has to check and repair. So let's see, we have still IOs here, right? Oh, there we are. There's our login screen.
Yeah. Node 1 is joining.
Yeah. Node 1 is joining.
Node 2 should be following shortly.
Yes, we see it here.
Yes, there it is.
There it is. So we should see some action soon. Yeah, there we get a running repair process.
Yes, it's starting to happen.
Yeah, so the second node is up. We can close this one. And where's our VM? Our VM is still happily running. I can move. Yeah, this is the watch cluster PS1 has a little bit of a refresh problem here, so I started again. You see it, two nodes. So our repair processes are running, and it will not take 2 hours. So I will include the video now, and we will come back and talk about or we will see the repair process finishing.
So just for the viewers, what makes the repair so fast?
Yeah, it knows what it should test. So it knows the system were gone for maybe 10 minutes. We had still I/O, and it knows this I/O should be on these disks. So it will not check all 25 or 30 terabytes in the system that were gone. It will
so it's
only
just
repair
doing the delta.
Yeah, it will only repair what's missing, or will put the blocks there that should be on those system. Yeah. Okay, we come back soon.
So now we're looking live at the system we use in our showcast. We have here a flight case with four Dell R7030 XDs and one 10 gigabit switch from Cisco. This is obviously not a production setup. For a production setup, we should have at least two switches, because if one switch fails, we need another switch for redundancy. But let's look at the Dell system. So every system has four SSDs. This is this row. So 1, 2, 3, and then the first place in the second row is also a SSD. So we see a lot of traffic or a lot of I/O on the SSDs, except these two, and then on the other SSD also. But we have also I/O on the HDDs. From here, these two and this row are also all HDDs, and we see some I/O here. So our system is also moving some data from the mirror tier that is in our SSDs to the double parity or LHC tier. We see some blinking here. So this is a setup, and we're going now back to our showcast with Didier.
So what's happening here? We are at 95 in this one.
Yep.
10 in this one, 38 in this one, 16, 21. So it will take, I think it will take some minutes, maybe 15 minutes. Yeah. Huh?
You were generating quite a bit of I/O, of course.
Yeah, and you see here, we have a lot of IOPS already. He's using all the nodes.
Yeah. And he's hitting them extra hard because he's rebuilding, right?
Yeah. So I'm quite impressed by the storage basis direct, I must confess.
But what's also nice is that it feels a lot more, you have a lot more visibility on what the problem is and what to fix and how to fix it.
Yeah, and this should also run. I didn't know why the debug storage subsystem.
And this is evaluation version, right? RTM.
This is eval, yeah. And it is RTM bits, but maybe I'm missing one update.
Repair true.
Repair what?
The first column, repair true.
Ah.
So scroll up a bit to the header.
Oh, everything is. Yeah, it's okay. Let's stop this and do it again. So we will see the header. Will we see the header? Yes. It's background task.
Yeah.
So he is still repairing. The numbers are changing. 50%. You see it here. It will take some time. So if we use another PowerShell, for example, to get the virtual disks in service. So they are repairing operation status. I think the pool is maybe, the pool should be fine again. Get storage pool. Tab is not working very well. Storage pool. It is healthy again. All disks are there. You say get physical disk. It shouldn't do
so. This indicates to you that all the disks are there. If one disk would have failed during this exercise, we would still see that fact that hey, you've got an issue.
Yeah. So you see here, every disk is healthy. They are rejoined to the pool, and he's repairing. So everything is fine here. Yeah. So we have already our 500,000 IOPS. That's impressive. I like it. We can move our roles back. They are all running on S2D 4 and 3.
And wouldn't that happen automatically?
Yeah, you see here. He already moved some roles back. Because there's another nice feature in the cluster, right?
Yes.
How it's called? It's Fairshare.
So basically you will notice that normally the disks are spread out amongst the cluster, and there is an affinity of the VMs with their storage. So they follow the storage.
See here? 4334. That would be nice, but it isn't.
Not yet. Or are we still waiting for that?
Yeah, but what he did, he already started he moved already two of the VMs first node, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 to the second.
Well, I've tested it. I started a three node cluster with block level storage, mind you, not storage bases.
Yeah.
And I just started all the VMs on one node left. And I've put it on the load balancing on being aggressive. And I came back after 10 minutes, and all my VMs had spread nicely across the nodes.
Yeah.
So that was nice.
Yeah, here's something. So one disk is already repaired.
Yeah.
If you see here, 35. We have only four disks now in the repair. One is repaired. I think that's the collect volume because it's the smallest. It's only 1 terabyte or 0.5 terabyte. The other are still repairing. Yeah. So maybe we should move the disks around a bit.
No,
the cluster should... The cluster should do that.
Yeah, that was my question. Normally, it should do it itself, right?
Yeah, but he's still repairing, and we don't want to wait. Okay, or should you want to wait another hour? So I would do it on the one.
But are we now not, creating more or less I/O on the east-west traffic or not? It's a trick question.
It is. And look here, we have a suspended job, but it's running again. Complete,
yeah.
Yeah. So there's something happening if I move a disk. So let's move the second disk to the second node. And you will see maybe here, suspended. One job is suspended.
Yeah.
And of course, we have no I/O on the host because he has to realign the disk. Yeah.
Yeah.
Your question was, of course, we have a lot of east-west traffic because the disk is maybe presented on the third node, or we had the disk 1, S2D1, was presented on the third node. But there were VMs running on the first node. So we have to use the east-west traffic to use the virtual disk on the third node. Yeah, and then the I/O is spreaded again in the cluster over the east-west traffic to write, for example, or read our blocks from the different disks, right?
Also, yeah.
Yeah. So I think that's very nice. And you get the best performance, of course, if a VM is running on the disk on the node.
Which normally it tries to do.
Yeah, it tries to do, yeah. But we would have to wait a little bit because it's not repaired fully. And I think we have to test it, of course. It would be move the workloads around later. If they are fully repaired, maybe it first repairs the workloads and then move it around. But we don't know that, right?
Yeah, I haven't tested that one.
Yeah.
That scenario.
Yeah. Yeah, there is a lot of stuff to test. So we are repairing still three disks. Yeah. And what I like here is that you see how much bytes are already repaired. So we know 72%. It's around, what is it? Kilobytes, megabytes, gigabytes. Yeah, you can see how much he has to do.
So can I go and peek in my cluster events?
Of course. No wins. Some errors.
Okay.
That's nice. You can look at the event log, the local event log, but
yeah. I can also do that. Yeah.
We are looking for the right logs, right?
Yes, I'm looking for
failover clustering or storage.
Let's try storage. Let's see what we
storage
have.
Storage spaces. Only 36,000.
Operational, nothing happened, but diagnostically. Oh, this is a nice
for internal use. I love it. So actually, we have two disks completed, and the third will be completed very soon. It's 96%. There you have some errors, right? An error occurred during method execution. You have to
spaces storage enclosure. So yeah. I'm betting he's having.
Yeah.
Yeah. Has established a connection.
So yeah, but you have to remember, I turned off two nodes.
Yeah, yeah. To power off, right? Just unplug the power.
Not shut down. We turned them off, and I'm quite impressed how stable the system is. We have no I/O loss. We have no VMs, at least.
Have you managed to make it crash?
No, not yet. If we had pulled a disk in one of the remaining hosts, we would have some data loss, but it will repair it. We can lose two complete nodes, but not another disk in the remaining nodes, right?
Yeah,
that's important to remember, and for that it's very important that we left space in our pool, so that if a disk fails, the system can immediately do a parallel rebuild in the pool on other disks.
Yeah.
So, for example, imagine a 4 terabyte disk fails, and it has to repair the disk on the data should be repaired in the pool at once, so that we have all the resiliency back, and that is done in parallel, so we don't use hot spares for that, because hot spares are very slow. A 4 terabyte disks, maybe you can write on it with 100 megabytes per second, and to do that, let's use a calculator, because all the time I talk to people about that calculator. Where is the calculator gone?
I'm sorry, I was moving the mouse.
You moved my calculator?
No, your mouse.
My mouse. So let's say we have 100 megabytes per second. If we want, so in 1 second we do 100 megabytes. So we need 10 seconds for a gigabyte, right? 10
Correct.
Seconds for a gigabyte. For a terabyte, we need 1,000. We have to multiply it by 1,000, so then we have the time for a terabyte. And if we have a 4 terabyte disk, we have 40,000 seconds if we write 100 megabyte per second. That would be divided by 60, we have the minutes, divided by 60, we have the hours. That would be 11 hours if we would use a hot spare. Yeah, and that would be not acceptable. So if we have 10 or 20 4 terabyte disks and one fails of 20, the system can rebuild the data on multiple disks, and we will have multiple times the performance of 100 megabyte per second. So that's very important. So what is our system doing? We have only two disks left.
Yes, and it's nicely increasing the percentage complete. So
yeah, and also the IOPS are increasing.
Yes. Well, the less less data you have to rebuild, the more IOPS are available for workloads, I guess.
Yeah.
That makes sense. Now, would you build a two-node cluster, Carsten?
It's a very good question. For a small deployment, you have one node with your workloads, the virtual machines. Let's assume hyperconverged, right?
Yeah,
so you have
yeah.
one workload with your virtual machines and your local storage. And a two-node cluster, you have your data is on both nodes, and you can use the power of both nodes for virtual machines. So I think it's a nice setup, huh?
It is a nice setup, yeah.
Yeah, you have a complete redundant system. It's like, let's look at it. It's like the data is on both hosts. You have something like storage replica, but not using storage replica. You use storage spaces direct. And you have a cluster. So if one node goes down, the other will start all the workloads. So I think it's a nice setup. I actually think it's a nice setup. And look at the Kepler 47 system. I've done a video with Dan Lovinger about the Kepler 47, and it will be available soon, or is already available when this video comes out.
Yeah, I think the little Intel driver and the Thunderbolt is still probably not public. I don't know.
Yeah, he said that they got the driver from Intel. Oh, look here, our disks are nearly
nearly done.
Nearly done. Only one is missing, and now everything is fine.
But do you think some of the OEMs might be building a little Kepler system of themselves with perhaps a bit more high-grade components?
Yeah, I hope so. I hope so.
I was thinking, like, what if we can turn a Vertex into a storage spaces direct box or something like that?
Yeah. Yeah,
it's
nice,
small.
Nice idea.
It works on an ordinary power supply.
But
I don't know. Just as a form factor.
Yeah, but the Vertex, I think, had shared ZAS, or?
Yeah. But I'm just thinking.
Direct don't like.
I know. But I'm just looking at the form factors.
Yeah.
That if you say to a customer, look, I have 10 branch offices where I need a cluster.
Yeah.
But it can hold up to 4 nodes. So what if we redesign that you know form factor with 2, 3, or 4 nodes, and you have this. You can scale out a bit, but you can start with 2 nodes, put in a branch office. It's built for a branch office already. You just need to swap it to storage spaces direct, basically.
Yeah, that's quite a good idea. But did you look at the screen? All our disks are repaired.
Yep.
We have 100% complete. Our system is fine again. It will pick up IOs. We are already at 700,000. So I think nicely done, Storage Spaces Direct system.
Pretty impressive.
Yeah, we turned off 2 of the 4 nodes. It was all the time running. And now it repaired itself. It took maybe 20 to 30 minutes. It's, of course, it is time, but we had it under heavily load. We had still 60 VMs running, doing disk speed in it. Yeah. So it's not a system is not repairing without workload. It's heavily used while it's repairing. So I think that's quite impressive.
It's nice.
So let's end on this, on your, that's nice, and the next Hyper-V Amigo Showcast, we will talk about DDA, right?
Oh, let's do that. Let's, you know, I still have this concept to come back to the Storage Spaces Direct.
Yeah.
You know, build a hyper-converged 4-node system.
Yeah,
and put in some
Tesla CPUs.
Tesla GPUs, and you've got a pretty sweet system for a VDI solution.
Yeah, you have only one problem: you can't move the workloads, right?
If you do DDA, but for remote AVIX.
Yeah.
So we've been playing in the lab with a mixture. So we give some of the VMs, we give remote AVIX, and only a couple VMs we give GPU pass-through, so a DDA, even with an NVMe as an experiment. And we say, look, these are the truly, really high-performant VMs, but they are not highly available, but the other ones are. And it's actually quite nice to be able to have that flexibility. So if somebody says, look, I prefer my raw performance over my high availability, you can actually do that within the same system.
Mm-hmm. So I actually
kind of
saw
cool next week.
Yeah,
or whatever.
Not next week. Give me a little bit more time. But I actually saw that one host was not doing much I/O, and so I moved the workloads back onto it. So you saw a live migration of 10 VMs in the background while you were explaining about DDA and remote AVIX, and that's quite nice.
Yay!
Okay.
So it's not picking up. Anything on node 2 already?
No, it should be, right? Owner node, what's happening here? No, nothing on node 2. Why is that?
Let's put some workload.
Why it's not doing any work there, right?
Yeah, we have. what is your node fairness set to? Is it aggressive mode or?
I didn't play with it, actually.
Okay, then it's a default, so it's pretty relaxed.
Yeah, it's pretty relaxed. So let's put some workload on the second one.
No. I actually had to tune that down, the node fairness, because I was doing demos for a presentation, and with the RTM bits, I needed all my VMs to be on one node for the demo.
Yeah.
And I'm blah 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 explaining stuff. At the moment when I want to go back to do my demo, all my VMs have balanced out. Okay, great.
So now you see, we moved the VMs over, and now the hosts are doing workloads. And why is the one? 1111111111. They are spread over different nodes, right? They are not on the first one.
Just sort on owner node. Just sort on zone. Then we'll see it.
Yeah, the name of the host is in there. So now, but. Look at that. We are doing 10 live migrations while the storage system is working. And I think all overall, Windows Server 2016 Hyper-V clustering software-defined storage is amazing.
Yes. Yeah. And especially this is rocky RDMA, so yeah. CPU load-wise, this is nothing.
Yeah. Okay, cool. But I think we are nearly at 2 hours now. No, it's 1.5 hours. Let's finish here. And
before my disk fills up.
This was a very. I'm very satisfied with what we have shown here, and I hope our viewers are too. So, let's put it out there and see what's happening. Say goodbye, Didier. Goodbye.
Bye bye. See you next time.